Video Killed the Radio Star presents Extended Play, The Artist's View. With the sad passing of Whitney Houston, Video Killed the Radio Star pays its own tribute to the artist's prolific career through her music videos and the directors who created them.
Looking back on it, I always remembered right back to that first video when I did How Will I Know that she was going to be a big star, because she had, first and most importantly, she had the ingredient that mattered. She sang uniquely. Nobody sounds like Whitney Houston. Lots of people have tried to mimic her, but nobody sounds like her. In the early days, in sort of 1979, 80, that sort of time, I did videos with a lot of women. I did She Works Hard for the Money with Donna Summer. She liked the video, she liked the ideas, but she liked the way the women looked. She was one of the first black artists that I'd ever shot with. Interestingly enough, at the time, there was hardly any black music on MTV. So Donna Summer was one of the first, as I recall, one of the first videos that got on to MTV, and it led again to me working with another black singer called Tina Turner. I did a number of videos with her. The most successful one, I think, was called Private Dancer. And again, conceptualized video, but Tina still looked fantastic in it. Again, led me on to another number of female acts, but the next biggest one, as it were, was Aretha Franklin. This was great for me because I've been a fan of Aretha since I was 14 or 15. I mean, in the 60s, you know, when Respect came out and all those great soul, Tamla Motown and Stax and Atlantic Records, I was a massive collector of black music from that time. So to get the chance to work with Aretha Franklin was amazing. We did this track in Detroit called Freeway of Love. So drop the top, baby, and let's cruise on in. And that was a massive hit in America. So in 1985, I was in LA. I'd been asked to speak at a music video conference, and I bumped into a guy called Peter Barron, who worked at Arista Records, and he had a cassette, and he said, listen, we've got this artist that Clive has signed. He's got great hopes for her. She's very beautiful. Her first album's doing very well, and we wondered if you'd be interested in making a video with her. Her name's Whitney Houston, and the track's called How Will I Know? So I said, sure. So I took it and I listened to it. It was a great piece of music. And that was how the beginning started. The only thing is we had to, for various reasons, had to make it in London. So Arista agreed to that, and Whitney came to London. In those days, you know, that there wasn't a lot of pre-meetings, as it were. I dreamt up a concept. In fact, I think I wrote a concept on the aeroplane coming home. So Whitney turned up. A lady called Denise Steiner was our stylist, and she dressed in some lovely clothes. And it was actually quite tricky to get her out of a Winnebago at first, and I wasn't sure what that was all about. But the truth is, she was just very nervous and very shy. I didn't know why she would be nervous, because she's a performer. She's performed in front of lots of people. But the reason was to surface.
I remember getting a call from Brian Grant. He was part of a company called MGMM that made every groundbreaking video that has ever been seen to this day. And could I do this video with Whitney Houston? I thought, oh my goodness, the goddess of song. As usual, the there was going to be no time to choreograph it, so most of it was going to be done at 5 a.m. in the morning before we started shooting at 9. So I instantly got together my very best dancers, and I couldn't wait to meet Miss Houston. Her playback was perfection. You would think that every word of the song was coming out of her mouth, but what the feet were doing were less than delightful.
Arlene discovered very quickly that she couldn't dance, so your job as a director at that point is to create a place where the artist feels safe, where you're not going to make them look silly. So I just said, look, you don't have to worry about any of this. The name of the game today is just to have as much fun as possible, to enjoy yourself and do what you do best, which is to sing, and let us do all the other stuff. The dancers were absolutely fantastic with her, made her feel completely at home. There was no standing on ceremony, there was no entourage that day, there was just her and the guy from the record company, and it was just a really good, fun day, and I think Whitney really enjoyed herself, and I think it shows in the video. We built a set that was like a maze. It was made of polythene and it had printer's ink splashed all over it. That was why the colours were so strong. The song's all about, is the guy that I'm after, how will I know if he's the right guy? The maze was a sort of metaphor for this, the maze of dating and finding guys and going out with them and which one is the one. You know, that's what the marriage thing is all about. It's what the doors are all about, who behind each one of these doors is a guy, is he the right guy? And if you look at the video, there's a moment where she opens the last door and one of the guys comes out and hugs her. And then he says something to her, which is completely ad-libbed. I've no idea what it was, but it made her fall about laughing, and we left it in the video. And it was very much how that day went. It didn't matter if it was perfect. What mattered was the energy. When I was first talking to Whitney on that first day, she sort of said, you know, I've seen the videos you've done with Tina and especially the video you did with Aretha Franklin, Freeway of Love. I really liked that. It's really good. And I said, well, thank you very much. And she said, did you know that she is my godmother? And I said, you're joking. I said, no, she's my godmother. There's a sort of synchronicity there, sort of destiny or something. There's a line in the song where she says, I'm asking you because you know about these things. You know, it's like, is that a best friend or could it be somebody, a mentor, somebody older? I thought, why don't we put Aretha in there? Because I'm sure at some point in their lives, you know, Aretha has given Whitney Houston some advice. I'm sure she's given her plenty of advice. So I just said to Whitney, why don't you just turn around and in post-production, we'll put a shot of Aretha in the background. And it's like, and she loved it because it's, you know, a godmother. The thing about Whitney is when she smiles at you, you can't take her eyes off her. I mean, that's the thing about anybody who's a star. She already had screen presence. One of the things I always did, and I learned this from stills photography, was I did a sort of master close-up. I'd clear the studio, so it was just me and a camera and Whitney. And she sang to me, basically, that amazing voice. 10 feet from you is quite astonishing. But the thing I absolutely remember the most was the moment she smiled, my knees went. They went wobbly. I always remember this because it was the power of that look was incredible. Hey, I played the tape back to her. She saw it and thought, oh, okay, now I know what you're doing. And from then on, it was easy working with Whitney because, again, her confidence was there and she knew that singing was what she did best. I got copious amounts of faxes from the record company, from Peter Barron. They all loved it. They loved how fresh she looked, how beautiful she looked, how vibrant she looked. I remember Peter saying, you lot looked like you were just having a lot of fun. And I said, well, that's the truth. That's what we did. It was harmless fun. That's what we did. So the second video came from the second album. It's called I Want to Dance with Somebody. And for various scheduling reasons, we had to shoot this in New York. I sat down and I wrote an idea, and the idea was that it was like every single scene had nothing to do with any other scene. It was like a photographic book. You turn over a page and there would be another scene, there would be another photographic scenario, as it were. So we jumped on a plane and went to New York. I think we had a couple of days to put it together. So Arlene and I went casting for the dancers, and Whitney and our stylist, Denise Steiner, went shopping, basically. And they just went out and got some of the most beautiful, colourful, vibrant, fun clothes that she could get in New York. One of my favourites is the black skirt with the red around the bottom. I thought that was a fantastic choice.
When we arrived, I had to get four dancers. They wanted four male dancers, and they wanted them instantly. So there I was in New York, in my bedroom, on the phone, to try to get four of the best dancers I possibly could that once again would have a rehearsal the morning of the shoot. So it was, can you learn fast? Because if you can't, you're not right for it.
Arlene found four of the most amazing New York dancers. They were absolutely sublime. And again, they were great personalities in the studio. We were all on top of each other with the amount of sets that I had in this tiny studio. But in the end, it was just the same thing. We just had as much fun as possible.
There was no place we could rehearse. We were shooting on one side while the other set was being lit in one form or another. We would jump across there and shoot, and then we'd go back to the other set, which had been relit. It was crazy.
The track's called I Want to Dance with Somebody, and the thing that Arlene and I were wrestling with all the way through this was the fact that we knew Whitney wasn't a great dancer. So how could we do this? I mean, the track demanded that you had dancers in it. So we kind of did the thing we do best. We disguised it, basically. Whitney, she had the same concerns, but she also knew what we were good at, and she'd also had one experience with me and Arlene in England. And I said, look, it's the same story. We'll surround you with all this fireworks, and you do what you do best. And the most important thing is that you reflect what the song's all about, which is what she does best. It's all about, you know, having fun, being in charge. I want to dance with somebody. I'm going to dance with somebody. And again, what we've got to do is just have as much fun as we can. So we had two fantastic days, very busy days. Sent off the first cut to Arista in New York. Eventually, I get a phone call from Arista saying, we have a little bit of a problem. We like it, but Clive isn't sure. I suddenly find myself on a phone call to Clive Davis, the Clive Davis, who discovered Whitney in the first place. I had quite a robust discussion with Clive, and he was saying, it's not quite sure, it's the direction that we want Whitney to go in. I always remember saying to Clive in that conversation that here was a beautiful 21-year-old woman having one success with her first album. She's going to be a star. You've got lots of time to create something else with her. This is the time that she should just be having fun. And that's basically what that song's all about. I want to dance with somebody. So Clive came back and he said, look, we've got this idea that Whitney's on stage singing a live performance. She comes off stage and she's slightly melancholy, and she has a vision, and the vision is the music video. And that's how Clive rationalised getting from reality into a sort of fantasy video. By the end of it, Clive was very happy. He sent me a lovely telegram, actually, lovely fact, saying how thrilled they were. So I Want to Dance with Somebody was a number one hit in America and worldwide, I believe. And it won Best Female Video at the MTV Awards, which was great.
We did a series of videos that had nothing to do with what I feel was my, you know, core, you know, in my heart audience, metal. But it does make a difference because I learned that, of course, Whitney rocks. You know, what's great about working with Whitney is that she was excited about the opportunity or the thought process of doing something a little more raw than the pop, you know, video she had done before. We did something that was a true live experience. So emotional was exactly what it's supposed to be, is a live, raw experience. So I, you know, hooked up with her and her record company, her manager and all that. And then it was began the phone call. Her father wants to meet me. What? I go, her father wants to meet me. I don't know, like the only person that her father, you know, had to meet was my wife. So I met with her father, who was her manager at the time, to make sure that I was okay. And it was all about love. It was all about the beauty of her performance. And when you talk, I just want your mouth. Whitney is a true artist, a true, like, not diva in the diva sense, but diva in the sense of, you know, exciting, beautiful energy. I think she really enjoyed the concept of me setting up this gig, people waiting outside, everybody excited, people showing up with their banners, which she hadn't had her shows, and her just going for it. It's like, to me, going, go, just go for it. She had a great time, and I really had a great time because for her, she got so excited about it, you know? And I was used to that excitement, but she got so excited about it.
Of you every step of the way.
I think the legacy that Whitney leaves is of somebody who was able to take the soul genre and absolutely make it her own. I always felt that the only other person who owned it better than anybody else was Aretha. Nobody sounded like Aretha. For years, still nobody sounds like Aretha. And I think Whitney appealed to R&B fans, to black fans, to soul fans. She appealed to pop fans. She appealed to middle-of-the-road fans. I suspect she even appealed to country fans. I mean, Dolly Parton wrote one of her greatest hits. So goodbye. She was one of those artists who was able to cross all genres and, you know, was supreme at it. And I will always love you. I will always love you. to be able to stand and sing the national anthem at the NFL that time, I remember that. And, you know, I'm not a sentimental person particularly, but that was a very, very moving moment. For anybody to get up, I mean, when Muhammad Ali got up and did the Olympic thing, the whole of that country was looking at that young lady, and she touched everybody. So it's a remarkable achievement.